Yeah, so good evening, Sneha. Good evening, Dipali, once again. So here we are to continue with the topic is which we left yesterday in between derivatives and commodity exchanges. Any doubts if you have studied the concept? Any doubts, any questions? So, as nothing is coming up, we start from where we left yesterday. Yesterday, I told you a situation. And when I was actually thinking on what we had discussed in the class, I was thinking that there is one thing which I did not connect yesterday, and which I must do it today before we take it further. I told you that there is an importer and there is an exporter, right? So, the importer and exporter, they enter into a contract. And they say that the importer said that I will be buying dollars, and the exporter said that I would be selling dollars, say at 39 rupees, right? Because the importer had a concern that if the price of dollar, price of dollar goes above 39, then he would have to pay a higher amount. And the exporter had a concern that if the price of dollar goes below 39, then he would be having a situation, he would be having a loss, right? We discussed this example yes in the yesterday's class. I hope you remember. Then, I started discussing with you about margins, and then I discussed with you about mark-to-market margin. Now, there is one thing which is disconnect between these two things, that if the contract is between an importer and an exporter, then who is going to collect the margin? Isn't it? Didn't you find that there was this disconnect? Then who is, because I was just wondering that when I had asked that is something required to be paid in advance, Neha said no. So then I was thinking, why did she say no? And then I thought that yes, because my example is for a transaction which is over-the-counter transaction. See, when an importer and an exporter, they enter into a contract with each other, this kind of a transaction is called over-the-counter transaction. This is between two independent parties. They come in contact with each other through a broker or through a mediator or through an investment banker, and they enter into this a kind of a contract, right? In such kinds of transactions, there's no concept of margin. Though the parties can deposit a particular amount in an escrow account, which they may open up, but that is not mandatory. So this is not called margin. Margin is required when the transaction is happening on a stock exchange. When the person who wants to buy dollars, like the importer, he goes to the exchange, and the exporter who wants to sell dollars, he also goes to the exchange, and both of them are doing the transaction on the commodity exchanges, on the futures exchanges. In that situation, the margin requirements are there. I hope you're able to understand. But when the transaction is over the counter, then we do not pay any margins. Is it clear now? I hope I did not leave you with a confusion, and if it was there, then I wanted to clarify that. Now, the second question which I want to take it today is that how do we calculate profits and losses in a derivative contract? It is similar to any other contract for that matter. I told you that if I am an importer and if I need to make a payment after 6 months, what I would like to do, I would like to enter into a futures contract where I would like to buy dollars in that particular contract because I want to freeze my buying price, right? And if I am an exporter, I would like to sell dollars on a future date because I want to freeze my selling price. Right? Right? Now, the question is that someone, as I told you earlier also, in this market, the person who takes the buying position is having a long position. And the person who is having a selling position is having a short position. Right? Yeah. So now, if I use a technical language and try to place it in my example, I said that the importer has a long position and the exporter has got a short position. Fine? Fine? Importer has got a long position and the exporter has got a short position. Now, when will someone make money out of this particular contract? Now, what do I mean to say? See, the importer will make money when the market price of this particular of dollar increases from 39 rupees to 40, 41, 42. Then he's making a profit because he has been able to buy at 39, which is available in the market now at 40, 41, 42. Right? Right? And the exporter would be happy, would be able to make a profit when the price goes down. He has sold for 39, but if the price goes to 34, 35, 36, he would be making profit. So when the price goes up, the importer, the person who is having a long position, would be paid by the exchange. And when the price goes down, at that point of time, the exporter who has got a short position will be making money. Right? He would be paid because it is a cash settled kind of a game. Right? So the person who makes money would be made, would be given the payment, and the person who makes a loss would be required to make the payment. Theek hai na? Right? So if the market price goes to 34, in that situation, the importer the importer will pay to the exchange 4 rupees per dollar, and the exchange will pay to the exporter $4, isn't it? Right? Are you able to follow what I'm trying to say? Okay. So if you've been able to understand this, let me ask you a question. Can I? So it says that an investor buys a Nifty futures contract. So investor has got a long position on Nifty futures contract for rupees 2,80,000. Lot size is 200 futures. Investor has bought Nifty futures for 2,80,000. Lot size is 200 futures. When we go on the stock exchange, particularly in the derivatives market, the contract is generally in certain given lots. So you have to buy the contracts in given lots. Here the lot size is 200 futures, right? But this kind of a lot size is, when we do the calculations, it would not make much of a difference. On the settlement date, now when the lot size is 200 futures and he has invested rupees 2,80,000, so in this situation it seems that the price of the futures was 1,400 rupees, right? Because 2,80,000 divided by 200 is equals to 1,400. Okay? So he has bought it for 1,400. On the settlement date, Nifty closes at 1,378. Find out his profit or loss if he pays 1,000 as brokerage. So whether he's in a profit situation or in a loss situation. What do you say? Investor had bought Nifty futures for rupees 2,80,000. Lot size is 200 futures. And on the settlement date, Nifty is closing at 1,378. So he has purchased for 1,400 and the market has gone down to 1,378. There is a loss situation, as rightly said by Dipali. Loss of how much? ₹22 per contract. Right? So 22 multiplied by 200 is equals to 4,400 rupees. Now, we have to find out his profit or loss if he pays 1,000 as brokerage. So if he has paid 1,000 as brokerage, so 4,400 plus 1,000 is equals to 5,400 is his loss now. 5,400 is his loss. Right? Now the question goes further. It says, what would be the amount of profit or loss if he has sold the futures contract? If he would have sold for 2,80,000 and the Nifty would have closed at 1,378, what would have been his profit or loss? In the mirror image situation, what would have happened? In case he would have sold and the Nifty would have closed at 1,378, he would have a profit of how much? ₹22 per contract, rightly said. So when the buyer is making a profit, the seller is making a loss. When the seller is making a profit, the buyer is making a loss. And that is how this market settles. right? But brokerage has to be paid in both the situations. So it's the broker who's making profit, whether someone incurs a loss or someone incurs a profit. Broker is always getting his money. So therefore, in the second situation, he will have a profit of 4,400, but he will have to pay a brokerage here also. So 1,000 rupees will have to reduce there also. So he gets 3,400 rupees with him. Fine. Now I slightly complicate the question because that was simple for you. Okay. It's a situation of a wheat trader. The wheat trader has planned to sell. So in any case, the broker will get rupees 1,000, of course. And that is why most of the professionals, they do not trade in the market. They take a terminal and they try to earn brokerage out of it. So whosoever makes money or loses money, the broker gets his brokerage. Okay. Now let's go to another question. A wheat trader has planned to sell 440,000 kgs of wheat after 6 months from now. From six months from now, he wants to sell because he would be getting his supply of 440,000 kgs after 6 months, and he wants to sell it after 6 months. Okay. Now the spot price of wheat is 19 rupees per kg. Spot price at present, spot price, as I told you in the last class, spot means that at present the price of wheat is 19 rupees per kg, and 6 months future on the same is trading at 18 rupees 50 paisa per kg. If he sells it in the futures market, just 1 second, Ganesh, let me finish this question and then I'll come to your query. If this particular person, if this wheat trader, he decides to sell it in the futures market, the futures market price is coming as 18 rupees 50 paisa per kg. Contract size is 2000 kgs. Now, the price is expected to fall to as low as 17 rupees per kg 6 months hence. The market is expecting that the price of wheat will fall to 17 rupees per kg after 6 months, and he would be able to sell only after 6 months. Now, he has got a risk. At present in the futures market, he can sell it at 18.50. But if he waits, the price may go to even 17 rupees. So he would like to sell it in the futures market. Why to take the risk? Isn't it? So what the trader can do to mitigate the risk of reduced profit? He should sell in the futures market. Isn't it? Isn't it? In order to mitigate the risk of reduced profit, it is advisable that he should sell in the futures market. That's fine with us. Now Ganesh is asking, ma'am, in the last question, if the investor sells the future, then only he can gain profit. Otherwise, he has a loss. No. Yes, of course. If he sells, then he was in a profit because a seller will gain if the price comes down. And the buyer will gain if the price goes up. Right? So when the price has gone down, in the selling position only we would be able to make profits out of it. Okay. So now coming back to the wheat trader situation. Now if he decides to make use of futures market, what would be the effective realized price of its sale when after 6 months spot price is 1750 and futures price is 1755? Before we go further on this question, I must clarify this to you that on the settlement date, like if we enter into a contract for 6 months right now, then on the settlement date, the price in the spot market and the price in the futures market would come very close to each other. The reason is that the difference between the price in the spot market and price in the futures market in general should be the difference of the rate of interest between the two dates. Isn't it? Ideally. So when we are coming to the settlement date, so then there is no time gap, and because there is no time gap, so therefore there is no interest rate differential, and therefore the price in the spot market and future market, they come very close to each other on the settlement date. So this has happened in this situation as well. The price is in the spot market is 1750 and the price in the futures market is 1755. Theek hai ji? Theek hai? The question is clear? Is the question clear to you? Any doubts on the question? It is clear. Okay. So now, supposing he decides to sell, because it says, supposing he decides to use the make the use of futures market. So what he can do, he can sell in the futures at 1850. Now we want to understand what would be his effective realized price. So he decided to sell in the futures market at 1850, and when the on the settlement date, the future price is 1755. So has he made a profit or has he made a loss? He has made a profit of how much? Per kg, if you can tell me, you may not go into the total amount. Per kg, how much of profit he has made? .95, very true, very good. So he has made a profit of 0.95 in the futures market, right? But we have been told to find out effective realized price. So the futures market will pay him 0.95 per kg for 440,000 kgs. Right? Right? Because in the futures, we generally talk about cash settlement. Right? So the futures market will pay him 95 paisa per kg for 440,000 kgs. So what would he be getting in the futures market? Can you calculate? He would be getting 418,000 rupees from the futures market. Now, what will he do with his wheat? Because he has got the wheat now. So, he would be required to sell this wheat in the spot market because futures market has already paid him the differential amount. So, he goes to the spot market and he sells his wheat there. 440,000 kgs for 17 rupees 50 paisa. Right? Right? So his effective realized price would be 18 rupees 45 paisa. Let me show you the solution. So what he does, he takes a short position in the futures market. So he has to hedge 440,000 kgs. The contract size is 2000 kgs. So he would be selling 220 contracts of wheat in the futures market at 18 rupees 50 paisa. He has an exposure of 81,40,000 in the futures market. After 6 months, he will have to square off his position. So he squares up his position in the futures market by buying. That squares up means he simply closes his position. So if you have sold, you will have to buy. If you have bought, you have to sell. So when he buys in the spot in the futures market at 1755, he gets 77,22,000. So his gain is 418,000, which Dipali has already calculated. That is the way we are presenting the question. But effectively, we have done our calculations. So he has got 418,000 rupees in the futures market. Now he has got the wheat. So he needs to sell his wheat at 17 rupees 50 paisa. When he sells 440,000 kgs for 17,50,000 paisa, he gets 77,00,000 rupees. Now, he has got this amount and he has got this amount. One in the spot market and one in the futures market. Because both of them are his receipts. So, we add them together. It becomes 81,18,000. Right? So, effectively, per kg, what he has been able to get is 81,18,000 divided by 440,000. He has been able to get 18.45 rupees per kg. Is it clear? Is it clear? So when the market price is 1750, he has been able to get a good price for himself, 1845. It's a wonderful price that he has got. Right? Clear? Is it clear? Okay. One more. Can we take one more question? Okay. Now, you know what is beta? Okay. Now, we have been given... No, beta is not risk. Beta is an indicator of risk. That too, systematic risk. Right? So, Zenith Company Zenith company has a beta of 0.5 with Nifty. Now, what does this mean? What does this mean? Zenith company has a beta of 0.5 with Nifty. What does this mean? It means that if Nifty increases by 100%, Zenith company share increases by 50%. Right? If Nifty decreases by 10%, Zenith company share decreases by 5%. Right? That is what is the meaning of beta all about. Okay. So Zenith company has got a beta of 0.5 with Nifty. Each Nifty contract is equals to 100 units. So the lot size of Nifty is 100. Zenith company now quotes at rupees 250. And Nifty futures is 4000 index points. In the spot market, now quotes means that in the spot market, the price of Zenith company is 250. And in the futures market, the price of Nifty is 4000. Right? The question is getting clear? Because we have got two different markets. We have got a spot market. In the spot market, the price of Zenith is 250. In the futures market, the price of Nifty is 4000. X is long on 1200 shares of Zenith company in the spot market. What does this mean? What does this mean? X is long on 1200 shares of Zenith company in the spot market. X has purchased 1200 shares of Zenith company in the spot market. So how much money he has invested? 1200 multiplied by 250. He has invested this much of funds in the spot market. Right? Right? Yes, he has invested 3 lakh rupees. Now my question is that in case he wants to hedge himself against the price fluctuation, in case he does not want to take any risk with the change in the price of the shares of Zenith company, in that situation, how many futures contracts should he take? If he wants to completely hedge himself, then what he should do, he should take an opposite position in the futures market, isn't it? If he has bought in the spot market, he should sell in the futures market because one person's profit is another person's loss, right? And one person's loss is another person's profit. So here, because he's already taken a buying position in the spot market, it is advisable that he takes a selling position in the futures market. He should be short in the futures market. Now, how many shares, how many futures contracts should he take? That's a very big question. I want to fully hedge myself, right? Now, I have been given that the Zenith company has got beta of 0.5 with Nifty. That means that even if I take half a position in Nifty, I would be able to completely hedge myself. Because beta has got a because Zenith has got a beta of 0.5 with Nifty. So that means even if I invest 1,50,000 rupees in Nifty, I should be completely hedged. You're able to follow what I'm trying to say? He has invested 3 lakh rupees in Zenith company. But this has got a 0.5 of beta with Nifty. So even if he sells Nifty for rupees 1,50,000, he would be able to hedge himself. Okay, right? So we tell him to sell Nifty for 1,50,000. So we can find out how many Nifty he has to sell. Because for one contract he has to invest 4 lakh rupees. So he may be required to take less than one contract. Right? So 4 lakh divided by 150 is the, 150 divided by 4 lakh is the amount, is the number of contracts he needs to enter into. So let me show you the calculation. Since X is long on the shares of Zenith company in the spot market, he will have to go short in the futures market. He will have to sell Nifty. Now the market value of the holding to be hedged is 1200 multiplied by 250 multiplied by 0.5 is equals to 1,50,000. How many contracts he has to sell? 1,50,000 divided by 4 lakh. So 0.375 contracts if he sells, he would be completely hedged. Now the question goes further. If the price in the spot market drops by 10%, how is X protected? If the price in the spot market drops by 10%, that means that he would be having a loss of 25 rupees per share in Zenith company because the price will drop. He has a buying position, and if the price comes down, he would be in a loss. Yes or no? Yes. He has purchased Zenith company for 250. If the price drops in the market by 10%, Zenith company would be for 225. So he would be having a loss of 25 rupees. So he would be having a loss in the spot market of 25 rupees, 25 multiplied by 1200. Right? But in the futures market, he will be having a profit, because when the price drops by 10%, when the spot market drops by 10%, okay. So when the market will drop by 10%, Zenith company will drop by 5% only. I was wrong in my interpretation. If the price in the spot market drops by 10%, then Zenith company will drop by 10%, or maybe the futures will drop by 20%. We can take it either ways. Right? Either we say that the spot has dropped by 10%, so futures will drop by 20%, or we can say that the futures has dropped by 10% and then the spot will drop by 5%. But I think we will take it the other way. We'll say that if the price goes down by 10%, Nifty will go down by 20%. Okay. It says if the price in the spot market drops by 10%. Now, price in the spot market has dropped by 10%. That means Zenith company share has become of 225. Yeh theek hai? This is fine? Okay. So, in this situation, this investor has invested in 1200 shares. So, he has got a loss of 1200 multiplied by 25. That's fine with us. That's 4 lakh rupees, I think. Nahi, zyada ho gaya. 40,000 rupees. Kitna loss hoga? 25 into 1200. 30,000. So, sorry. Okay. So, he will have a loss of 30,000 rupees. Now, when the price in the spot market drops by 10%, because this Zenith company has got a beta of 0.5 with Nifty, so Nifty will drop by 20%. Yes or no? Right? So when Nifty drops by 20%, the price of Nifty would be 3200 rupees. Because it was 4000 index points. So Nifty would come to 3200 rupees. Right? So when Nifty comes to 3200 rupees, now you have a position where you have got 0.375 contracts on Nifty and you've got a profit of rupees 800 per contract. So 800 multiplied by 0.375 multiplied by 100, sorry, 800 multiplied by 0.375 multiplied by 100 would be equal to 30,000. Right? Right? Because he has taken 0.375 of 100. So that is why we have taken 100 multiplied. So he has made a loss of 30,000 in the spot market, but he has got a profit of 30,000 in the futures market, and he is completely hedged. He is completely hedged. Right? Now let me take it the other way around. If the price in the spot market would have gone up and he would have made a profit in the spot market, then he would have made a loss in the futures market. So in all situations he is hedged. Right? So you have understood how we use this futures market to hedge ourselves. Now, when we are hedging ourselves, we are not making any profits. Okay. Ganesh, I'm just explaining it again. See, the thing is, I'm saying that he had purchased 1200 shares of Zenith company at a price of rupees 250. Okay. Right. Now, what happened? This price in the spot market, it went down by 10%. So that means that this price has become 225. So that means that he has had a loss of 25 rupees on 1200 shares. So that is equals to 30,000 rupees. This is fine. This is a notional loss. He has not sold these shares so far. Okay? This is just a notional loss. But in the futures market, the contract has to be settled. Now what has happened is that he has also taken a reverse position in the futures market. In the futures market, he had sold Nifty. For rupees, he has sold 0.375 of the lot of 100 Nifty at rupees 1200. No, at rupees how much it was? At rupees 4000. Right? So he had sold these many Nifty at rupees 4000. Now because Nifty has got a beta of 0.5, sorry, Zenith has got a beta of 0.5 with Nifty. So that means that when Zenith has gone down by 10%, Nifty must have gone down by 20%. So when Nifty has gone down by 20%, he has, because he has got a selling position and the market has gone down, so he has made a profit of 30,000 rupees in the futures market. Did you get my point now? Here he has made a profit. Here he has made a loss. So net of what has happened? Why 0.375? The reason was that Nifty was available in the lot of 100. So in order to buy one, you know, so that means that one Nifty was for 4000 and it was available in the lots of 100. So if you wanted to invest in Nifty, you had to invest 4 lakh rupees. But because my exposure in the spot market was less, so I had to invest only rupees 1,50,000. So what I did, I had to invest 1,50,000. But one contract which was available in the market was for rupees 4 lakhs. So I had to take 0.375 contracts. You got my point? Though it is not available like this in the market, but for my calculation, I have to do this. In the market, if you go and say that I want to buy 0.375 contract, they will not give it to you. Okay? Now here, let me just explain the thing to you. He has right now, practically speaking, not sold these shares in these Zenith company shares. Right? He can sell. I'm not saying that he cannot sell. But even if he does not decide to sell, he feels that, okay, I will keep it with myself. But I do not want to have a sleepless night. So what he has done, he has squared off his position. He has squared off his position in the derivative market. Now what has happened is, this, supposing he had purchased it on 1st of October, and at the same time he had entered into the contract in the futures market as well. Now it is 30th of October, and on 30th of October the futures market would pay him 30,000 rupees. Right? Because he has made a profit there. And futures are cash settled. So futures has paid him 30,000 rupees. Is it clear? Is it getting clear? And he still is holding the shares of Zenith company at 250. But he is not concerned, because even if the market has dropped to 225, he is happy. Because he has been able to get 30,000 rupees back. So his cost is now 225. He can still retain these shares. If he feels that no, this 225 is something which is very temporary, the market will again go up and he would be able to make again 250 out of it. That would be his income. If he wants to sell off in the spot market right now, he can do it at a no profit, no loss situation. If he feels that this fall in the market is just temporary, and again Zenith company will go up, he would be making profits here. If he still feels that no, there is still a risk, Zenith company may again go down, he can again enter into the futures market and book his deal. You're getting my point? Yes? Ma'am, futures price determined by demand and supply. All prices, whether it is the spot price or it is the futures price, all prices are determined by demand and supply only. Okay? So the concept has built up now. You've been able to understand why derivatives, how derivatives. That is clear? Okay. Now let me just give you some more technical aspects of derivatives market. As when I started the class before Ganesh could join, I had discussed with you the difference between the over-the-counter derivatives and the exchange-traded derivatives. Just for a recap, Ganesh, I'll just share with you. I was just sharing with Sneha and Dipali that yesterday when I gave you the example, I gave you the example of importer and exporter entering into a contract. So that if and the importer says that I would be buying dollars at 39 rupees and the exporter said that I would be selling dollars at 39 rupees, right? And then I gave you the concept of margins and I told you that these two people, you know, those who enter into a futures contract must pay a margin. But those two things were not matching. If the importer and exporter are entering into a contract, who will collect the margin, right? So I just wanted to make that thing very clear. When an importer and an exporter, they enter into a contract with each other, it is called, like without the exchange in between, it is called an over-the-counter contract. Importer and exporter entering into a contract with each other, it is called over-the-counter contract. In that kind of a contract, there is no concept of margins. In this kind of a contract, generally there are merchant bankers who help these importers, exporters or any other parties enter into these kinds of contracts. In order to ensure the transaction, they can open up an escrow account and where they can keep the money. But that is completely between the parties, how they decide to ensure safety and all these things. But at the same time, because of the risk of, this is called counterparty risk, because the counterparty may default. Supposing, you know, the price of the dollar becomes 34. Now, importer may feel that why should I buy dollars at 39 when in the spot market it is available at 34? Let me not fulfill my obligation in the futures contract and simply go and buy in the market at 34. This is the concern which Ganesh was also sharing in the previous class yesterday. He was saying that what if the purchaser, what if the counterparty does not fulfill the obligation, right? So in that situation, the only remedy with the exporter is to go to the court of law. And in the court of law, the amount that will be spent on litigation may be more than what the importer has given him a loss. So he may not feel like going into the court of law and the matter would, you know, become very, very difficult. The entire exercise would go futile, right? So in this situation, the remedy to this has been given by the exchange-traded derivatives. Remedy to this has been given by the exchange-traded derivatives. What are exchange-traded derivatives? See, there was a very big risk in the over-the-counter derivatives because the parties... So, Sneha, I think I suggest in case you would like to log out, you can. So, Sneha, what do I say? Just a second. Okay, what I'll do, I'll stop the video. Maybe then in that situation, she would be able to hear. Sneha, is it better now? I've stopped the video. Is it better? No. Oh my God. Okay, just wait for some time. Okay. So now we were just trying to understand the difference between exchange traded and the over-the-counter derivatives. Now in this situation, we are saying that if what if the counterparty does not fulfill its obligation, so we suggest that in case it is possible, that there can be a stock exchange which comes into the picture. Now the importer will also enter into a contract with the stock exchange, and the exporter will also enter into the contract with the stock exchange. Both the parties do not know each other, and the stock exchange takes the counterparty guarantee. So if the importer will run away, then the stock exchange, it will be the responsibility of the stock exchange to recover, but the exporter would be paid his money. And if the exporter will run away, then again the exchange will look into that matter, but the importer will be given his profits, right? And now how will the exchange look into the matter? Exchange has evolved with the system of margins, of initial margins and mark-to-market margins. So exchange has already kept the money with itself, right? Right. So which one is better, exchange traded or OTC? Which one is better now? Come on, tell me. Which one is better? Ganesh is saying exchange traded. Okay. Abhishek also agrees with him. But there is a problem. As it is hedged. Hedging is there. As it is safe, you would say. As there is a counterparty guarantee. Uh-oh. Just a second, huh? Okay. So what I'm saying here is that agreed that exchange provides a counterparty guarantee, and the exchange traded contracts are better. But then, you know, there is one difficulty with exchange traded derivatives. When we were discussing the last question, I told you that though the requirement was that the party enters into a contract for 0.375 units of index, but the contract as such is not available. So in case you want to enter into a contract on stock exchanges, on the exchanges, then you have to buy in the specified lot sizes. Then you will be getting a standardized settlement. So if the contract on the exchange will expire on 30th of October, your contract will expire on that date only. You cannot buy a contract with a settlement date of say 18th of October or 17th of October. But yes, on that particular date, you can liquidate. You can sell off your contract at the market available rates. But the contract of a different, of a particular maturity date and of a particular size is not available on the stock exchange. So you will have to buy standardized contracts only. Whatever is available, you will have to buy that only. But in the over-the-counter derivatives, you can enter into a contract based upon your own specifications. Right? Right. So the benefit of over-the-counter is that it can be customized. But the benefit of exchange traded is that it gives you the counterparty guarantee. So it's like, you know, when you go to a tailor and get your clothes stitched, you can get the dress stitched as per your requirement, your size, your liking. And if you go to the branded stores, you would be able to get only the standard sizes. And if that fits you, fine, good enough. If that does not fit you, then you have no choice. Similar is the case with the exchange traded and the OTC derivatives. So when we talk about OTC, the over-the-counter derivatives, they're also called forward contracts. They're called forward contracts. Okay? So these are bipartite contracts. Bipartite means that these are the contracts which are entered into between the parties 1:1. And this contract has to be performed in future The terms are decided today. For example, if Jay and Viru, they enter into a contract to trade in one stock of Infosys 3 months from today, that is the date of contract, at a price of 4,675. Now here, Jay and Viru, both of them are entering into a contract without any stock exchange in between. So it's a forward contract. It's the over-the-counter contract. All the other things will be same, in whether it is the forward or a futures contract. Here, the product, that is the Infosys shares, the price, that is rupees 4,675, the time, that is 3 months, they are all decided in advance, right? That is why it is called a forward contract. The delivery and the payments will take place as per the terms of this contract on the designated time and at the designated place, right? So delivery, so everything will happen. But there is no counterparty guarantee in this particular case. And that is why it is called a forwards contract. How is it different from a futures contract? Because in this particular contract, there are two problems. One is the counterparty risk. If Jay does not fulfill the contract or if Viru does not fulfill the contract, the only remedy that they have is to go to the court of law. Second thing is, they have entered into a contract which will settle 3 months from today. Now, supposing in between Jay feels or in between Viru feels that he does not want to continue with the contract, he cannot liquidate this contract, he cannot sell it to somebody. But if you enter into this a kind of a contract on the exchange, both these problems are getting solved. You can come out of the contract at any point of time, because on exchange every day there are buyers, every day there are sellers. So you can liquidate, you can come out of the contract at any point of time. And secondly, the exchange gives you a guarantee of counterparty risk, right? So the remedy is you go to a futures contract. Now there was a question in December 15 examination, distinguish between counterparty risk and operating risk. Distinguish between counterparty risk and operating risk. Counterparty risk is clear to you? What is counterparty risk? Counterparty risk is the risk that the opposite party will default. Either party will not obey the contract. That is the risk. Okay? It may default. That is my counterparty risk. So counterparty risk is also known as default risk. That the other party to the contract may not honor its commitment. It will breach the contract, very rightly said. So this risk is always present in a forward contract or in a over-the-counter contract. This counterparty risk arises because the price of the goods, the delivery, when the counterparty does not fulfill its commitment with respect to quantity or with respect to the place of delivery or with respect to the price, then it is called the counterpart. Then there is a problem, right? So, or it may happen because one of the parties, if one of the parties goes bankrupt, then again, there is a counterparty risk, right? Now, these transactions are bilateral lateral transactions. They're not exchange traded, so therefore it is not at one party side, it is at both the sides. Both the parties are having this a kind of a risk. Compare it with the operating risk. What is operating risk? Operating risk is the risk which is because of operations. Risk which is because of operations. This risk can be there even at the stock exchange, because this is the risk because of people, processes and systems. Because it may happen that I have entered into a contract on the stock exchange, but then because of some system failure, because of the fraud by one of the brokers on the stock exchange, my contract may not even have been entered into on the stock exchange, right? So operating risk is the risk which is there in any business. It is not only on the forward, but also on the futures. It is because of changes in technology. It may be because of changes in the management. It is risk which is there because of processes, because of systems, because of any kind of a operation which is there, right? So operating risk is there in any kind of a business, whether it is futures or it is forwards. And whenever, you know, when we talk about it from the perspective of leverage, operating leverages, we also say that wherever there is a high fixed cost in the business, which we studied in the capital structure chapter, wherever there is a higher fixed cost element in the business, then there is a higher operating risk. So they are understanding it from that perspective, right? Now when we talk about forwards, let us look at a contract in the forwards market. I'm not taking a contract with any kind of a risk. I'm simply taking a forward contract. Okay. Ankush Limited has a plan to raise an amount of rupees 50 crore for a period of 3 months, 6 months from now. What does this mean? That this company, Ankush Limited, wants rupees 50 crore. Raise means it wants to either come up with an IPO or it will be borrowing these rupees 50 crores. Okay. So it wants to raise 50 crores for a period of 3 months. They would be needing this money for 3 months, but this requirement would arise 6 months from now. Okay. So today we are saying that we are right now in the month of October, November, December, January, February, March. In the month of April, on 1st of April, I would be requiring 50 crore rupees. And that money will be required by me for a period of 3 months. After 3 months, I will repay this money. Okay. The current rate of interest is 9%. But it may rise in 6 months' time. Right now, in the month of October, the rate of interest is 9%. But when I actually need the money in the month of March, this rate of interest may go up. And the company does not want to take any risk. Right? So the company wants to hedge itself against the increase in the market rate of interest. The situation is getting clear to you. Company does not want to take any risk on the rate of interest. Okay. Bank of India has quoted a forward rate agreement at 9.5% per annum. Yeah, raise means to collect from the market. Bank of India has quoted a forward rate agreement at 9.5% per annum. That means what? Bank of India says that, okay, 6 months from now, we will give you 50 crore rupees at 9.1% per annum for a period of 3 months. Okay? Is this fine? Because the company is very skeptical about the increase in the interest rates, so they can enter into this forward rate agreement because Bank of India is quoting them 9.1% per annum. Okay, now find the effect of this FRA and the actual interest rate cost to Ankush Limited. If the actual rate after 6 months happens to be 9.5% or 8.5%, now this is like the wheat trader example, isn't it? The wheat trader had also sold the wheat at 18.5 rupees per kg, and after 3 months or after 6 months, the price of the wheat in the market was 17.55. Similarly, here Ankush Limited has decided to borrow at 9. Rate is yearly, per annum it is written, right? So Ankush Limited has decided to enter into a forward rate agreement at 9.1%. The market rate, the spot market rate, can be 9.5% or 8.5%. Is it clear? Is the question clear to you? Now, what should Ankush Limited do? If the market rate of interest would be 9.5%, if the market rate of interest is 9.5%, in that situation, Bank of India, because these contracts are all cash settled, as I've already told you, right? Bank of India will pay 0.4% to Ankush Limited. No, it is, no. It is 3 months holding period, 6 months from now. As I told you, right now it is October. So they would be needing money for a period of 3 months in the month of April. Okay, Ganesh? Because companies, they are able to project that how much money they would be requiring, and this can even be a bank, right? Am I not clearly audible? Can you hear me? Okay. So what I'm trying to say over here is that Ankush Limited, when it comes to the month of April, when it comes to March end or April 1st, at that point of time, Ankush Limited will go to the bank and the contract has to be settled. Now the market rate of interest is 9.5% and Bank of India had quoted a forward rate agreement at 9.1%. So Ankush Limited would be getting 0.4% of rupees 50 lakhs from Bank of India, right? 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 Okay. And what it will do, it will go and borrow in the market at 9.5%. Is it clear? It will go in the market because these contracts have to be cash settled. So it has got 0.4% from the Bank of India and it will borrow at 9.5%. Theek hai? Theek hai? So let me show you the calculations. So if the actual rate would be 9.5%, bank will pay 0.4%. So 0.4% of what? 0.4% of 50 crores for a period of 3 months, because the loan has to be for a period of 3 months. Okay, so 50 crores multiplied by 0.4 multiplied by 3/12. So bank will pay to Ankush Limited on 1st of April itself rupees 5 lakhs. Theek hai ji? Now, because this amount has been paid upfront, Ankush Limited can deposit it in the bank. This 5 lakh rupees, Ankush Limited will deposit it in the bank for a period of 3 months. Because the rate of interest is 9.5%, so, and the amount will be deposited for a period of 3 months. So the bank, after 3 months, will pay to Ankush Limited 5,11,875. That's fine. Now, Ankush Limited has also borrowed at 9.5% from the market, right? So, it will pay 50 crore rupees, it will pay interest at 9.5% for a period of 3 months. So, the amount that it would be required to pay would be 1,18,75,000. But at the same time, it has received 5,11,875. So its net cash outflow is 1,13,163,125. Right? This is equal to 9.1%. If you calculate it, it will be equal to 9.1% of rupees 50 crores for a period of 3 months. Okay, so it has restricted its cost to 9.1%. Theek hai ji? Now we go to the second situation. In the second situation, the market rate of interest is 8.5%. The first situation is clear to you? Is the first situation? Yeah. Now the market rate of interest becomes 8.5%. You have already entered into a contract at 9.1%. and the market rate is 8.5%. So in that situation, what will happen? In the situation, what will happen? Any idea, anybody? You have already entered into an FRA at 9.1% and the market rate of interest is 8.5%. What will be the... Limited will pay 0.6% to the bank because the contract has to be closed. So in this situation, Ankur Limited will pay 0.6% of 50 crores for a period of 3 months, that is ₹7,50,000 to the bank. Now Ankur Limited does not have any money. So Ankur Limited will have to borrow this, because in the last example, when the bank paid the money to Ankur Limited, what we did, We deposited this money in the bank. Now, because the 7,50,000 has to be paid out of the pocket of Ankur Limited, so Ankur Limited will have to borrow this money. Right? Right? When we have the receipt, we are depositing. When we have to make the payment, we'll borrow. Clear? So, 7,50,000 rupees, Ankur Limited will borrow for a period of 3 months at 8.5%. So, in this situation, after 3 months, Ankur Limited will have to repay to the bank 7,65,938. Clear? Clear? Samaj mein aa raha hai? Any doubts, anybody? Abhi baaki ka nahi padhna hai. Please don't read whatever has been written over here. Just try to understand what I am trying to say. Ankur Limited has to pay 7,50,000 rupees to the bank. So Ankur Limited will have to borrow this money. It will borrow at 8.5% for a period of 3 months. So then after 3 months, it will have to pay, because this money they will pay to the bank. And the remaining, after 3 months, because they've borrowed and paid the money, so they will have to repay with interest. So with interest, they have to repay 7,65,938 rupees. Now, what happened to that 50 crores? For 50 crores, they went to the market, borrowed at 8.5%. Borrowed at 8.5%. So they were required to pay 1,06,25,000. To this, we add 7,65,000. So again, the amount will come to the same, which is 1,13,75,000, this amount will come again, right? Which will be again 9.1% of the total funds. You're getting my point? So by entering into this forward rate agreement, Ankush Limited has blocked its rate at 9.1%. Is it getting clear to you? Neither more nor less. Okay. So that was an example of a forward contract, but a similar kind of a contract you can also enter on the stock exchange. The benefit of the futures contract is that you are able to get it in a standardized size in terms of quantity, quality, delivery time, place, and they are traded on the stock exchanges where the market is very, very liquid. So at any point of time, if you know Ankush Limited wants to close this contract during this period of 6 months, they can do it on the stock exchange. But when they enter into a forward rate contract with the Bank of India, they would not be able to close it in between. Right? So therefore, futures are more beneficial. Here, you also get a counterparty guarantee because the exchange provides an unconditional guarantee for the settlement of the trades. And therefore, you know, there is no credit risk in this kind of a transaction. So futures give you more liquidity. It gives you a counterparty guarantee. But in futures, the price, the settlement date and the underlying is clearly determined in advance. That happens even in the forwards contract. So now that we know what is future, now that we know what is forward, like, you know, Jay and Veeru had entered into a contract to buy, you know, Infosys shares after a period of 3 months. Now, supposing, you know, this Jay and Veeru, they do not enter into a contract across the table. They go to the stock exchange. Now, Jay does not know Veeru and Veeru does not know Jay because the stock exchange comes in between. So Jay buys from the stock exchange and Veeru sells to the stock exchange. Then it will be called a futures contract. So, difference between forward and future is clear. But one thing which would be coming to your mind again and again is that why should I enter into a forward or a futures contract? Because, you know, if I wait till the date of maturity, which is very particularly important in case of a forwards contract, I'm not even able to take the benefit of the decrease in prices. When I've already sold, I'm not able to take the benefit of decrease in prices. See, the thing is that if this Ankur Limited would not have entered into a contract with Bank of India, in that situation, they might have borrowed it at 8.5% also. And they would have been able to save this 7,65,000 rupees. Isn't it? Right. So, you know, till the time, there was a time, you know, in the history where people used to think that, see, I am not in the business of making profits by the fluctuation in the rate of interest. I am in the business of maybe textiles or maybe, you know, grains or whatever. So why should I put my mind on all this? If 9.1% cost of funds is suitable to me, I enter into this hedging and I'm fine with this. Even if the market goes to 8.5%, I am okay because I am able to sleep tight in the night because my cost of borrowing is fixed at 9.5% and I am able to make a reasonable return by borrowing at 9.5%. There was one particular set of people in the past who used to think like this. In present, people are very aggressive. So they feel that, no, this is something which is not done. I want to be safeguarded if the rate of interest goes from 9.1% to 9.5%. I do not want to pay a higher rate of interest. But there should be a mechanism by which if the rate of interest goes down to 8.5%, I should be able to take the benefit of that kind of a movement as well. You're getting my point? So I want to have, you know, laddus in both of my hands. Right? I want to safeguard myself from the increase in the price, but I do not want to, increase in the rate of interest, but I do not want to leave the opportunity of making a benefit by the reduction in the rate of interest. Is this possible? Is this possible? What the benefit of exchange to facilitate both the parties? I did not get this question. What is the benefit of exchange to facilitate both the parties? Okay, I got your point. See, the thing is that there are 2-3 benefits which I would be discussing with you. Why? I'm getting this point. Exchange is not getting benefited out of any of these transactions. It is just getting a broker is paying some fees to the exchange. It's a very marginal amount that it is getting. Why there is an exchange? See, this is the kind of a infrastructure which has to be, this is a kind of a financial infrastructure which is provided by the government so that people are able to do good business. Isn't it? If I have to do business and if I want to manage my risk, and if I have to enter into this a kind of an agreement, in that situation and the counterparty can default, then the government has to provide me with a court of laws, and there would be so many cases in the court of laws, and the litigation would be so expensive that people would not like to do business in the country. So if you have this kind of an exchange, which is able to provide you with a counterparty guarantee by devising a mechanism, And if you have an exchange which is able to provide you with liquidity by, again, you know, having lots of buyers and lots of sellers on this particular exchange, definitely, you know, it'll be good. Now, if you ask me that, why does the government provide you with a commercial space? Why does the government let the malls come up? Why does the government provide you with a sabzi mandi? Why does the government provide you with an anaj mandi? Because it is a platform, it's an infrastructure where people will come and buy and sell the shares. Right? You must have seen that movie Mohan Jodaro. And this kind of a marketplace is in existence since the time of Indus Valley civilization. Right? This is a culmination of that kind of a market. You got my point? Okay. So now I'm coming to the second situation. I'm saying that supposing Ankush Limited says that I do not want to close this transaction if the market rate of interest falls to 8.5%. In that situation, you know, I want to take the benefit of 8.5% rate of interest. But I want to be very, very sure that if the rate of interest goes to 9.5%, then my cost of funds should not increase to 9.1%. Can we provide that kind of a product to Ankur Limited? Yes or no? Can we provide this a kind of a product to Ankur Limited? Can I get some response here? How? Why not? Yeah, that's the spirit. So, yes, the answer is yes, we can provide that a kind of a product to Ankur Limited, which will come by the name of options. Which will come by the name of options, which I would be discussing with you in the next class tomorrow. Okay? So far, it is clear that if you want to freeze the price, then the futures market is available to you. But supposing you do not want you want to freeze the price for upside, but you do not want to freeze the price for downside. Or from another perspective, you want to freeze the price from downside, but do not want to freeze the upside. In that situation, you can move and buy the options contract, which I would be discussing with you tomorrow. Tomorrow, I would also be doing some more questions on futures, and then I would be discussing, in the next class. So in the next class, I would be discussing with you some more, you know, examples on futures contracts, a very few of them, one or two, and then I would be moving to options, right? So now my question before we close for today is that, are we ready for tomorrow's exam preparatory on basics of derivatives? Are we ready for tomorrow's exam preparatory for basics of derivatives? Yeah. So, now one more question. Tomorrow I have some commitments. So, can we keep the tomorrow's exam preparatory to day after tomorrow? Sunday, maybe in the morning or maybe in the afternoon, whichever time is suitable to you. We have another exam preparatory of ATLP at 5 o'clock in the evening on Sunday. Yeah, that's what I'm trying to say. It is already there. So we have just, I think Ganesh is a common student and there's another one, Neha, as a common student in both the exam preparatories. So I would like to understand from Ganesh, will it be a little too much for you? It's okay. Okay. So we keep the FTFM exam preparatory on Sunday morning at around 12 o'clock. Twelve thirty p.m. And then we keep the exam the ATLP exam preparatory at around 5 o'clock. Will it be fine, Ganesh? Back to back two tests. Yeah, we can keep it at 11 a.m. Of course. So is 11 a.m. fine with everybody? Abhishek and Dipali? That's fine. Perfect. Chaliye. So we keep the FTFM exam preparatory on Sunday at 11 a.m. and ATLP exam preparatory on Sunday at 5 p.m. Right now we close for today. Topic is basics of derivatives. Basics of derivatives for FTFM and excise procedures for ATLP. By tomorrow morning we'll be uploading this PPT up to this point. Okay? Chaliye. So with this, good night to all of you. Bye-bye. Take care of yourselves. Be prepared now that you've got 1.5 days to prepare. So you will have better time. So we want a better performance in the exam preparatory as well. Good night. See you in the exam preparatory. Till then.